Let's all stand together, and we'll open them with singing Arise, King of Kings. Help us to heal. And Lord, now we just ask a blessing upon this service this morning, upon the message that will be shared with us, that it might touch our hearts and bring us closer to you. And we ask all this in the name of your precious and holy Son, Jesus. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning comes from Leviticus 19, verse 18. Do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against one of your people, but love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. You may be seated.
In Christ alone, my hope is found.
Who is my neighbor? And he was asked that by in some scriptures it's called a scribe, in other places it's called a lawyer. It was one who practiced Mosaic law. He was a learned man, a man who stood in the crowd and questioned Jesus, who then is? How do I have eternal life? And who is then my neighbor? This was, you know, to the, you have to understand in biblical times that they were in a theocracy, and so the law of the church, or the law of the temple, was the law of the land, and so people were you had lawyers, judges, who were learned in the law. Okay, and that's the person, and he was actually. He was asking in his mind a rhetorical question. Now, what's a rhetorical question, class?
You know the answer.
Yeah, it's the one I already know the answer to. You see, he was testing Jesus. It's a rhetorical. I already know the answer to this, but I want to know if you know the answer to this question. Okay? And, yeah, I don't know. What was the man's heart? Was he really testing Jesus? Sometimes we give these people a bad rap, you know, but wouldn't we do the same thing if we had a teacher and we were trying to question them and see where they were theologically? We might ask that question, right? A question that we knew the answer to. Where do you stand on grace? Where do you stand on water baptism? Where do you stand on eternal life, eternal security? These are questions that we might ask, right? We already feel like we know the answer to them, and we have a bias and maybe a prejudice. So we don't know if he was trying to trap Jesus. Sometimes that was certainly true. But the Bible says he was testing him. Does that mean he was entrapping him? I don't know. May or may not have been, but he wanted to know where Jesus was doing this. And this question is relevant. It's extremely relevant in our society today. You know, as we've looked at the news, my next slide had all of those things on there that are going on in our world. What's going on in our world? Class, coronavirus, unemployment, economic collapse. We've all seen. We've seen all of these things. There it is. The things that, you know, who knew who George Floyd was, you know, a month and a half ago? Nobody. Relatively, no one. And so you have all of these things. Black Lives Matter, defacing property, and all of the things that are going on in our country. Okay? We're talking about today biases and prejudices and assumptions that we make. Now, sometimes biases and prejudices get a bad rap, too.
I'll see if I can just
get it. That's okay. Everyone, how many of us have prejudices? How many of us have biases? Yeah, we all do, based upon who we are and how we were raised. What do you think these women do for a living? How about the woman on the left? What do you think she does for a living? The one on your right, I'm sorry. My left. I'm sorry. The one on the left. Right.
The
one on your right.
Short hair?
Yeah, the one with the short hair.
The glasses.
Yeah.
Secret Service.
Secret Service. There you go. It was in security. Yeah, but you maybe don't necessarily think about it. I mean, a guy in the dark sunglasses, it's an obvious giveaway, right? He has to be Secret Service or some kind of
CIA. Maybe black something. Yeah.
Yeah, it has to be. And how about the woman on the right?
Lawyer?
She is. She's the top attorney that is on. Man, you guys are good. So you guys don't even have these prejudices and biases. Go ahead to the next one. Which one of these guys is the Supreme Court Chief or Supreme Court Justice, former or present?
The one on the right.
The one on the right or left?
Left.
You're right. The one on the... The one on the left, your left. You're right, I'm sorry. See, it's my right, it's your right. The one on the right is who? First black African-American chief justice, or not chief judge, but justice. Who is that? Thurgood Marshall. Thurgood Marshall. Okay, was named Justice, 1967. All right, the other guy is a colleague of mine. He works at Shawnee's, he's a superintendent. He's a low life guy. Sometimes we think of feminine and masculine in these ways. And we have stereotypes. And some of it's based upon, the way that men and women are made. I mean, men and women, today there's this push that, men and women are basically the same. They are not. We all know that. But some of it's based upon socialization and the way that men and women are brought up and just in our thinking. Tim, if you want to go on to the next slide, we need to move on. Again, we all have biases. Biases are preconceived notions of a person based upon their outward appearance, maybe their name. If they got one of those long names with hyphens in it, maybe, I don't know. Position, social standing, where they come from, their race, their religion, their political affiliation. Right? Maybe their age or disability. Racism, that's a term that's in the news today. Racism, what is that? It's acting upon that prejudice. It's taking action and discriminating based upon that prejudice in an antagonistic way. Okay? Typically, we look at that and we say that those are... people who are marginalized, those people who are discriminated against or acting upon those discrimination are those who are maybe racial or ethnic groups. Historically, what's happened, Tim, if you want to go to the next slide, please, we've dehumanized and societies have. And this is where discrimination is taken to the nth degree. We dehumanize them, and then they are attacked. Literally, that's happened in this country. Unfortunately, it's also happened to the nth degree. Of course, in Nazi Germany, it's probably the modern day example of how humans were dehumanized, and so they were able to actually be exterminated. It's easier to kill someone. In World War I, when we entered the war, actually Woodrow Wilson hired a propaganda minister and they ran all kinds of advertising dehumanizing the Germans because we needed to go to war and fight them and kill them in battle. And actually, there were a lot of Germans in the United States, first and second generation Germans who came from Germany, and so we have that example as well. Let's go on to our scripture this morning. Luke, if you want to turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 10, if you want to follow along, or you can just follow along here on the board. Luke chapter 10, starting in verse 25. It's one of the greatest examples of Christian love and humanity, and especially talking about this idea of loving your neighbor and racism and those types of things. Okay, so chapter 10, verse 25. On one occasion, an expert of the law, a lawyer, stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus, not having that, turned the question on him, and he says, "What? What is written in the law?" Jesus said, "And how do you read it?" And the lawyer turns and he says, he answered Jesus and he said, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind. And, as Melanie read this morning, love your neighbor as yourself. That was part of the law. And so Jesus said, you have answered correctly. Jesus replied, do this and you will live. But the teacher, wanting to test or justify himself, he asked Jesus, Jesus, who is my neighbor? See, he thought that in his mind, he was asking again a rhetorical question, who is my neighbor? He thought that, again, if you look in the law and what Melanie read this morning in Deuteronomy, it was fellow Jews. So Jews were my neighbor. Okay? In the modern sense, Christians are my neighbor, Christians, brothers and sisters. And I don't have to love other people, and I don't have to care for other people. So if they're outside Judaism, then they're obviously outside of the law and the prophets and of the love of who would deserve it. So he's trying to test him and thinking. And of course, his way was the right way, the true way, the one way. And he wanted to test Jesus, see if he had that same model or paradigm. Okay? Verse 30, Tim, if you want. In reply, Jesus said, a man was going down. He didn't answer. Jesus doesn't give him an answer one way or another. He just tells him a parable. So we entered the parable. You guys know this story, right? We learned it in Vacation Bible School when I was a little kid. Your age or younger. In reply, Jesus said, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going by down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed on the other side. Okay? So to a Levite, who was also in the priestly line, when he came to the place and saw him, so he saw the man, he passed on the other side. So both of them saw the man lying in the road or beside the road, half or beaten and half dead, maybe even dead. They didn't even stop to see. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came to where the man was. And when he saw him, he took pity on him. And he went to him and he bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his donkey and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out at least $350 out of his wallet or maybe just gave the innkeeper the charge on his credit card. And he gave them to the innkeeper and took after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra money that you have. So you could actually say he just gave him his credit card number and said, you can charge whatever you need to my account on this. Okay? He acted upon his sympathy. Okay? And for this man. Verse 36. Which of these three, Tim, if you want to go to the next slide, please. Which of these three was a neighbor, Jesus is telling the story and he's still talking, to the man, who's a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robber? And the expert in the law replied, what's his reply? The one who showed mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. See, this parable in various versions of it had actually circulated. They were popular teachings in the Jewish tradition at the time Jesus was on the earth. But they always had the rabbi, the teacher, the scribe, the Pharisee as the hero of the story. Maybe taking care of a fellow Jew or a Roman soldier or another Roman citizen or a Samaritan. But Jesus completely turns this around and in one fell swoop He teaches the difference between compassion and sympathy. And if you want to go to the next slide, Tim. See, the focus of this is on the actions. Can you have sympathy without showing compassion? Do you think that the priest and the Levite both had sympathy for the man? I would think so. You'd have to have a pretty hard heart not to have sympathy for a guy who's laying half dead in the road, wouldn't you? But they didn't act upon that sympathy. See, Jews hated Samaritans. And Samaritans hated Jews. It would be like the viewers of Fox News and the viewers of MSNBC. Right? Or conservative Republicans and liberal Democrats. Would you stop in the road to take care of a liberal Democrat? I mean, this guy is liberal as liberal could be. One of those Hollywood, you know, movie star producer types. They deserved what they got, didn't they? We'll just let him lie. I feel sorry for him, but I'm not going to stop him and get it. See, actually, Josephus recorded two instances. Josephus, the Roman historian, recorded for us two instances of this battle. In 08, Jesus was alive. At 08 AD, the Samaritans, this is the hatred of the Samaritans. The night before Passover, they snuck into the inner court of the temple and they scattered human bones in the temple courtyard. The night before Passover. Okay? Now, what does that mean to a Jew? That means that if they touch that skull, if they touch that human bone, they're what? Unceremoniously unclean, and they can't even practice or have Passover. Okay? In 51 AD, certainly after Jesus told the story, but before Luke actually penned this and wrote this down, probably, these stories had been circulating. There was a murder of Jews coming to Passover by very similar robbers. They were murdered by Samaritans, robbers, like all those stupid Samaritans are. Sorry. All of those Samaritans are. They're obviously robbers and thieves. And so the Jews they went to the Roman authorities, and when they didn't get the satisfaction that they wanted from the Roman authorities, they formulated a vigilante group, and they went out to the local town in Jenai, and they burnt the city and they killed all of the inhabitants. That was the hatred that people had, Samaritans had for Jews and Jews for Samaritans. They had prejudice, they had biases, they had stereotype, and they openly practiced, what's that word? The D word. Discrimination. They openly practiced it between the two groups. It was mutual. But the focus of this parable is on action. It demonstrated compassion. Who is the hero of this story?
The Samaritan.
The dreaded Samaritan. Okay? And so Jesus breaks up all thought of cultural barriers and popular beliefs by humanizing, not dehumanizing, but humanizing Samaritans. How about the woman at the well? Same thing. Jesus tells the story. Did that actually happen? Yeah, it happened. I believe it happened. But it's a humanization. Was that Samaritan lady saved, do you think? You think we'll see that? I do. We don't read that scripture this morning. And there was another instance where a Samaritan leper was among some Jews. A leper. And these 10 were healed. One of the 10 was a Samaritan. And Jesus told them to all go to the priest and be clean and you'll be healed. Well, the Samaritan is the only one who actually went to the one true priest who could heal him. That was Jesus. He came back. The Samaritan, among all of those 10, the other 9 were Jews, presumably. The Samaritan came back to Jesus and thanked him and was not only healed, but his sins were forgiven. And he was cleansed, and I believe probably saved on that day. Again, humanizing the Samaritan race. Who are the racists in the story? Is it the robbers? It was the listeners. I'm trying to get ahead of myself. R.A. Culpepper, from Mercer University, Mercer University is a school of theology, a Southern Baptist seminary in Texas. He writes this: Jesus kills 2 proverbial birds of prejudice with one stone. First, he is making the point that loving one's neighbor is to transcend all racial and cultural boundaries. Second, Jesus is challenging the Jews' stereotype, negative generalization of Samaritans by casting a Samaritan as the compassionate hero. Dr. Jeremiah goes on, talks about sympathy and the difference between sympathy and compassion. Tim, you want to go to the next slide, please? Dr. Jeremiah talks about this, sympathy and compassion. Sympathy is an abstract academic concept to be tossed around. So we can talk about sympathy. Do we have sympathy for someone? And we can, we can have limited risk. You know, oftentimes I can talk about how sympathetic and how I feel about whether it's a racial person or a race of people or a group of other people, talk about how I care about them and how I'm guiding and I want to help. You know, sometimes it's the kids in my school. I can talk really good about how I love the kids in my school and do all of those things. But it's easy to toss those things around, but it's, what's your actions in that? It's analytical, and sometimes we weigh the consequences. Where on compassion, you see the things that are, you see the discrimination, the marginalization, the homelessness, and you take action. There's very little thought, but a lot of risk in taking action. There's limited risk in having sympathy, but you have a lot of risk in acting. The priest and the Levite, when they passed by, do you think that they might have said, I don't think I should stop. I might get robbed myself, right? The bandits might come back. That I might be unclean if this guy's dead. I won't be able to practice what I'm supposed to be able to do. So there are risks, and though there are risks in Christians today in the way that react and react to those people. You know, giving of ourselves, our time, our money, our reputations, and maybe facing rejection. Those are all risks that we face by going outside of our typical paradigm, model, cultural beliefs. you know, our son-in-law is a black man. You can't find a better guy than Joe. He's been here several times. He treats our daughter like a queen. She treats him a lot better than she probably deserves. Did we have prejudice and back? You know, when all of this stuff breaks out, the things that are going on in our country, we have to be very careful of telling other people how they should feel. Okay? Or how they should react. Because we haven't been in their shoes. And I guess I'm convicted in saying, you know, is there some basis to what the message that we are seeing in our country today that is dividing along racial lines? And I say, and I gotta say yes. I say that yes in a personal way. I say that yes probably as, I say that yes as a historian as well. There is some. There are some very valid points that have been made and should be made. Do I like the idea of tearing down public property? No, I don't think that should ever happen. I think the debate should happen in open form, in a democratic way. But it should happen. And it needs to happen. Are there people like the Black Lives Matter who are taking this to another level and using this as an agenda to push forth other things other than race? Yeah, there are. Okay? And so we have to be very discerning in who we support and how we support people. But just to dismiss it as something that is totally unfounded is, I think, not showing the compassion that we are called to do as Christians. The other thing that I would say is, and my wife teaches me this, because this is my wife's lesson, not mine. Now she's scared. You can't argue with somebody who isn't logical. If they're illogical, you can't argue with them. The only thing you can do is show them love. And that's what we're called to do in this passage. To show love. And it's compassion. It's the difference between sympathy and compassion. What are you being called to do to further the kingdom of God in bringing all people together into the body of Christ? All people, even Democrats. Okay? That's, I think, what we're talking about. Tim, if you want to go on to the next slide. And so we look at who are the racists. Tim, you can kind of go through those quickly. Is it the robbers? No, it's not the robbers. Go ahead. The Levite, no, it's not the Levite and the priest. They weren't the racists. Is it the lawyer? Yes, but he's likely all of those people. Go ahead, Tim. Jesus challenges people in this story to look beyond their prejudice, their biases, and their belief system. Go ahead, next slide, please. So what? How does today's story challenge us to look at the limits of our compassion for people? I don't know the answer. These are sort of rhetorical questions, but I don't know the answers. But you have to answer these questions individually. What does God require of us? And are we being neighborly as far as God is concerned? It's an introspective question that we have to deal with in the time in which we are living. What does God require of us? In the situation in which we are living, the climate, the culture, and all of the things that are going on around these race questions, are we the Levite and the priest? Or are we the Samaritan? And that's the question. How can I, what's God calling me to do to get involved, to heal the people who are broken in our culture, in our country? Let's bow our heads and pray. Father, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for the teaching that you have for us today. Father, you know that there is brokenness in this country. Indeed, Father, there's brokenness throughout the world. It's called sin. And we have the message, we being Christians in this congregation, have the message of reconciliation and healing. Father, help us to be good listeners. Help us to listen to others. Father, not just to have sympathy, but to have compassion, to act upon our sympathy and our convictions to bring healing to people, to bring healing to our country. Father, I truly believe in you are the answer. All of the money, all of the talk cannot bring healing outside of your church. And so, Father, help us, guide us, direct us, Father, and in our daily lives, convict us where we need conviction and guidance and direction. We ask all of these things in your holy name. Amen.
Let's all stand together and sing in closing, "He Has Made Me Glad."
Thank you.
Share that joy and compassion with our neighbors, to everyone, and to show them that we care about them, not just with words, but with actions. Lord, we ask your strength be with those who were not able to be here with us this morning. We ask for traveling mercies for those who are out traveling, and we just ask your constant presence in our lives, overflowing in our hearts. And it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.